This Sunday. Every Sunday. Side by side at the microphone, from the green light to the speed trap, Chris Switzer and Ray Garino calls them as they sees them, and you better believe them. Here! Relevant news, biased opinions, and outright bullshit regarding every aspect of automotive culture. Gas, but mechanical trickery never before revealed over FCC-regulated airwaves. Thrilled to the explosive tension as Chris and Ray cuss each other down the track and barrel roll across the finish line, laughing at certain disaster as they shake hands with the devil. All that and much more this Sunday at high noon on the Motormouth Radio Hour. Call in and speak live with the Wizards of Speed and live feed, Chris Switzer and Ray Garino. Bring the whole family. Kids under 12 get in free. Every Sunday at noon on WHPC. Take the Long Island Expressway to the Meadowbrook Parkway and look for the sign saying no parking on the expressway and no express service on the parkway. Go right on Highway 24 to Garden City. $2 all-day parking includes pit pass. Sunday!
Does he give you pleasure? Does she give you pleasure? Do we give you pleasure? I hope so, because you've tuned into Motormouth Radio, Long Island's only automotive talk show, with your pleasurable hosts, Ray Guarino, and the very pleasurable Chris Switzer. How are you, Chris?
Are we ripped?
For your pleasure, right. Yes.
Wow,
yes.
What a way to start off a Sunday afternoon. I love it.
You know, I tell you, and it's pretty cool because I visited our good friends at Infinity Records yesterday, and I picked up the CD version of an album that I have that Joe and I, you really dug on. This is West, Bruce, and Lang. You know, Leslie West?
I have never heard this. I almost thought it was Rod Stewart there for a second. Sounded like Faces.
You know, I'll tell you, it does. Here.
It's... Yeah.
Cool. It does kind of sound Faces like. You're right, but no, that's West, Bruce, and Lang. Why Don't You? And the holy grail for me has been there was a second album, and I have yet been able to find it. But now I found this on CD, and of course I paid the grand total of $3.99 for that gem. But it is a gem. It's one of those forgotten gems. And if you're a fan of that kind of music and those guys, it's good stuff. So good to see you back. We're a fan of you, and we're glad to see you back on the air with us. We missed you last week.
Well, thank you. And I'd like to thank Matt Goman Brian for sitting in for me. As always, he does a stellar job of warming my seat for me when I'm not here. So I'm very pleased. And thank you, Brian. Thank you for being there for me. Yeah. So how did everything go with how was everything with wrenching with
Kenny,
Larry?
Kenny. It was Kenny Wessel. I like the new arrangement of the ears, by the way. It's very nice. You got the custom treatment down there. Very good. I like that.
You got those big black ears removed.
Kenny, you know, Kenny is a YouTuber, for those who don't know. He was from New York and a mechanic by trade, went down to North Carolina now, and I found him on YouTube and started a dialogue, and he came up to visit, and he asked when he visits, can he come into the studio? And I said, sure. So, I mean, this was in the works for months. Right. You can hear the show. What's the easiest way to hear the show? is go on our website. It's not on our website because our website is like 9-10 months.
Website, we got to wipe the spider webs off.
But there's a link to WHPC, and if you go to WHPC and the podcast section, they're listed. Right. The podcasts are listed alphabetically, and we're in there, and it will be there. That's on Spreaker. It's also on iHeartRadio. But you can also go to YouTube. Go to Motormouth Video on YouTube, and the show is there. So you can watch it if you like. It was kind of weird because I had a weird camera angle with Kenny, and so he could see the screen. You couldn't see me. I had to keep stepping in every once in a while.
That cracked me up.
I know.
We saw your elbow.
Yeah. But you can still, you know, put it on and listen. And Kenny's a great guest because he's a I knew this would happen. We didn't touch the surface of many of the subjects I wanted to talk about because you just don't have enough
time. Oh, gee, what a surprise.
I know, I know. So, and we couldn't get him back in because, you know, he had to go back home. So,
right. Yeah. Well, hopefully we can get him on the phone and I can chat with him as well.
Sure.
I was out of town mm-hmm. this week. I was at a business meeting, and I had to go rent a car.
Uh-huh.
So, of course, here's what I do. I went over to budget earlier in the month, and since I had to go down there alone without the family, I rented the mystery car.
Oh, boy.
Mystery car. I had to do that. So, of course, when I get to the desk, flight lands, and I'm in Florida, the flight lands, and I step up to the budget desk, and I'm chatting with the woman, and she said, well, do you know what you want? And I said, I'm assuming whatever's in the lot, you're going to hand me the keys to.
How about a 69 Chrysler 300, lady? How about that? Right. Can you help me? Make me feel at home.
Take that back. So, but it's funny you should go there. So I said, well, what do you have?
Mm-hmm.
So she says, you want something sporty? I'm like, sporty? I went, well, okay, what do you have? So she said, I have a Camaro and I have a Challenger.
Wow.
So what are we doing?
We got let's hold your Challenger, and we'll go to the phones and say hi. You're on with the Motor Mouths, Ray and Chris.
Hey guys, how you doing? Good morning.
Hi, Cliff.
Good afternoon, it's Cliff.
What show are you at today?
You're cracking me up. So you're not at any show. I'm trying to repair a pool that the guy was getting installed in the middle of this rainstorm, and just had to pull the whole liner back off. It became a disaster.
Oh, no.
Well, that sounds like in the middle of this, I'm listening to you guys, and I'm listening to the mystery car, which cracks me up because I did the mystery car when I went to visit my daughter in Michigan about a month or two ago, and I think it was budget, too, and I got stuck with a Chevy Bolt or Volt.
Oh, yeah, right.
Oh, no way.
Yeah.
But meanwhile, I had to drive somewhere that was like really in a rural area that there was going to be no charging stations, nothing. I was like, I didn't want this mystery car anymore. It was a mystery on how I was going to charge it.
You know? Right.
But they were pushing. They had and the car had like 6 miles on it when they gave me. So they were pushing these brand new little tiny things. But yeah, the mystery car could be a blessing, but it could also be a curse.
So yeah. Why don't you let Cliff know what your mystery car? I think Cliff will be kind of pissed that he didn't get your car.
It's so funny. The woman at the desk says you want something sporty. So I said, sure, what do you got? So she said a Camaro or a Challenger. I said, give me the Challenger. I said, I'll take that. So she hands me the keys to it. I go out there. Yeah. It's bright fire engine red.
Yeah.
It's like poor red.
Right.
here I am in Daytona Beach,
right,
with a Sonic Red Challenger.
Nice.
I was like, oh, you gotta be kidding me. It was hysterical. But the funny thing was, I liked it. It was, and I'm telling you, it was just a rental hack. It was a six cylinder. It still had all the bells and whistles, but it was a nice car. It was inviting to be in. It was a nice place to be, sitting behind the wheel. So I maybe was very pleased. So I hate to tell you, but my mystery car was pretty good.
Maybe the mystery is a better mystery in Florida than it is in Michigan or Chicago area.
Yeah, I think so.
Well, the mystery may not be, but at least the answer is.
Yeah, you need the mystery cars down south, but not up north.
Well, guys, I was cracking up when he told me about the mystery car. I got a call and I said, I got the bad part of the mystery.
Yeah.
The good part of the mystery.
That's what I was hoping I would not get. I was hoping I wouldn't get an electric car because you're right; they are trying to push them.
Right.
So, yeah, it was bad. Yeah. And if you don't have time on your vacation to pull over and find a charging station, and believe me, they're not too easy to find in certain areas.
Yeah.
So.
Sure.
But, when you do find them, they're usually filled. They usually have people. That's what I'm finding very hard to.
You
got to
open up. You got to open up an app and an account and put a credit card. It's like, you know, you're away. You don't need that hassle.
Yeah, but, definitely.
I agree.
All right, guys.
Okay, Cliff. Thank you. I appreciate
the
call.
As usual. Glad you got the better mystery. I think Rick and the guys are there's two big shows today, right? Tobe and Point Lookout.
Yes, Rick is sending me
all the rain dates today.
Rick is sending me pictures as we speak. Him and Stan are going to give a call in and report on the show shortly.
Very nice.
All right.
Have a great day, guys.
Thanks, Cliff.
Thanks for the work.
Bye-bye. All right.
Thanks, Cliff. Stay dry.
Excellent. Yeah, a lot of rain dates today. All the shows that were rained out, everything got pushed. And now, of course, we got Tobey, and they're down in, I think, Nickerson Beach doing the show there. So we'll talk to him in a little bit.
And they can reach us at 516-572-7440. So yeah, I was doing a road test on a Challenger, and I gotta admit, the 6-cylinder wasn't so bad. The V6 was not.
No, they're not. They're really not.
It really wasn't. It wasn't a bad car. Yeah. I mean, the color was enough to blind you, but the car itself, I mean, it was better than like a pink or something. Sure. But the car itself was, I mean, everything. You know what I found interesting about the car, and I this is something that you would appreciate, right? Where the radio and AC controls were on the car, on the dash, you were able to just take your wrist, the bottom of your wrist, and just rest it on the shifter, on the console shifter. And if you did that, your fingertips fell on all the controls.
Nice.
Some former stoner or something who turned into an engineer must have thought of that.
Sure.
Because I was like, I'm just sitting there, just you know, waiting at a traffic light, and I was going to change the station on the radio, and I dropped my hand, and my wrist just hit the top T, the T handle of the shifter, and my fingers just fell onto the radio. Cool. I was like, this is cool. That's just good. A little bit. Just those little things. I was like, that's nice. Someone thought of that. That's cool.
We should have Rick and Stan calling us in now from the show. We'll see if if the telephonic communicators work. I want to tell you a story. I had gotten Cliff in on this, and Rick, in fact, and Billy Velvet this week. I had to get my wife's car inspected. It was the last car for the year. You know, it's like, whew, thank God. You know, I'll go back again in the beginning of the year. We're just cycling, right? So I went to Tire Town, saw a good friend Joe Gologli, across Smoking Joe.
Smoking Joe.
And yes. Joe told me about this the last time I was in, I think, when I had my car done in July. Now, the New York State now has new inspection stickers. And Joe is up in arms. He goes, what the hell do we need new stickers for? They finally got it. Of course, now it's costing the owners, the station owners, more money because there's a new printer and such. And I will finish that story after we take this. Let's do this.
This is the joy of live radio.
And we'll say, hi, caller. You're on with the Motor Mouths, Ray and Chris.
Hey, Ray and Chris. Hey, it's Rick. We're over at the Tobey Show. I'm with the president of the Corvette Society, and I have T. Kirk, Master Mechanic, with me. I'm going to put them on, but it's an amazing show. I wish you guys could be doing it out of this area here. But we're having a great time. We got the Corvette Clubs here. We got some great, great cars, a lot of Pontiacs, a lot of GTOs.
Yeah.
Stand
up. Yeah, we actually did a remote from there twice. Joe and I had done two remotes from that show back in the day. The big problem is the station doesn't have a generator. So,
okay.
Yeah, a little tough. You got to supply your own power. Yeah.
As the phone is getting handed off.
I guess so. It sounds like it's going through the crowd.
Yeah. I'm sorry. I put you on speakerphone, but I...
Bad idea.
It's such a big show here.
Yeah, that's a bad idea.
Yeah, exactly. You need to run, get into a vehicle or something, close the windows.
Right.
Hey, Ray, you there?
Yes, Stan, we hear you.
Hey, Stan.
How are you? Hey, how are you?
All right.
We're doing good?
Very good.
Tell us about the show.
It's a great show. You know what? The days after what we've been through is beautiful. And, you know, we came with about 17 cars ourselves, so we have a nice group of cars, and they have a nice array of cars here. Really nice stuff. Really nice stuff. A lot of Pontiacs. There's a lot of people here today, which is really nice, and a lot easier to get in than the last couple of years.
Oh, good.
Yeah. Only this morning it took us about a good, there must have been a 2-mile line long of cars waiting to get in.
Right.
Wow.
So how is that easier than the past, Stan? Because I've been on the line waiting, and I'm like, this is not fun.
No. Well, last year we must have come at a time where it was just between when they opened and we... To be honest, within 15 minutes, we were right in.
Okay.
Yeah, so we ended up leaving a little earlier today, thinking it was better to leave earlier. It was probably better to leave a little later. But we're in. It's all good, and we're all parked together.
So what's up? What's up with the Corvette Society these days? What do you guys got cooking?
Not much. I mean, our meeting is coming up this week. You know, we're at the tail end of the season. So probably we will ramp up again in January. We may have a couple of tech sessions and stuff like that. We're more into the hobby of the cars.
Right.
Right. So we tend to gravitate to learning more about the cars than anything else. So we try to bring people in like Ray, like yourself.
Yeah, I was at a meeting this year. You know, and I'll tell you something, Stan, I'm going to a meeting for the Oldsmobile Club this week where they're having the new proprietors of Nassau Chrome in Mineola as their guests.
Oh, you know what? I should speak to them as well.
Well, that's what I was going to say. I'm going to pitch them for the radio show, but I'll also pitch them for your club meet if you like.
Absolutely.
All right. You got it, brother. I'll do that.
I have Haggerty coming down. I have another gentleman coming down. And then next month, Ray, you may want to come. I got the original guys from the Pacers.
Oh, yeah. George Snyzik. Good friends of ours. Yeah.
They're both going to be at the meeting in November.
Okay, good. You got me.
George and Scott.
Yeah. Yes. So other than that, I mean, it's a great day. At least the sun is shining. It's warm. It's beautiful.
Absolutely.
Stan, what's some highlights? Give me some cars that are piquing your interest. What's there to be seen?
I'm all over the place, so I have a love for full-size cars. So there's plenty of GTOs here. There's plenty of Chevelles here. I just met a group of guys with about five Chevelles, 66 and 7s. They're all high school friends. And they've had cars since high school. Yeah, pretty cool. So met another gentleman with a beautiful 61 who's going to get involved with us. He just bought the car. So, I mean, as far as that, I mean, listen, I'm an old school guy. I like the older cars. I like original cars. So that really, that's what really is my interest, you know?
Right. So, yeah, same here.
Yes.
I get it.
But I also got T. Kirk here who wants to say hello. And sure. If you don't mind. Yeah, hold on. I'm going to put him on.
Sure.
Hold on 1 second, Ray. Thanks.
Who is this guy? He said T. Kirk?
Hey, what's going on, man?
Yeah, hi. Who are you speaking with?
This is T. Kirk. You know me as Tony with the 57 Vet from Corvette Society?
Oh, yeah, Tony. Sure. Yes. Good to
see you.
Yes.
What's going on?
How are you, Tony?
How are you?
How's everything?
Oh, man. Good. We're out here, like they said, enjoying the show. Beautiful day. A lot of cars. You know?
It's perfect.
So you have a 57?
Yeah, I have a 57. It's kind of like a resto mod.
It's a lot of resto mod.
Yeah, 434 and 9-inch four rear and suspension and AC, this, that, you know?
Right. Beautiful car.
Thank you.
Really?
Thank you.
Tony, last time I saw you at the Olds meeting, and I was wondering, I'm going to the meeting this week. Are you going to be there?
Yeah, I'll be there.
I'll see you Wednesday night.
You got it.
Okay.
You got it.
Very good. Listen, you keep those guys in line. Don't let them guys. I know Stan can get a little wild sometimes at a car show.
Nah, we're okay, man. Everybody's good. Yeah.
Very good.
Yeah, I'll probably say, actually, no, Wednesday? No, I won't be there Wednesday. I'm going to Bear Mountain. It's their last show for the year, so I'm going to take a drive up there.
Okay.
I won't be there this Wednesday.
Okay.
But yeah, we'll catch up, man.
Yep.
You got to come by my shop one day, too, man.
I would love to. Sure, I'll do that.
Yeah, come by and check it out. You know, I've been busy over there.
Right.
You know? So, but I appreciate talking to you, man.
Okay, very good, Tony. Always a pleasure.
You got it,
buddy. Thanks, Tony.
Thanks.
You got it.
All right. So long.
Wow. A highly modified 57 Corvette. That's awesome.
Oh, yeah. Rick?
Yeah. Yeah, you know, I got to tell you, the two guys you just spoke to, both of them have a tremendous collection of cars.
Yeah.
Tony has, like, an incredible amount with LS engines dropped in. He's got an amazing, that 57 Corvette, you guys could probably talk for, like, hours about what he's done to that car.
Yeah.
You see, right now, he's got a Fox body here that's probably pushing 800 horsepower.
Wow.
Stan has about 7 Corvettes. He's got an Impala. He's got a Chevelle. I mean, these guys have been involved with the car trade for like 50 years. I mean, and you know, all of us together, including yourself, hundreds of years experience.
Yeah.
But the show today is really, really nice. I mean, beautiful weather.
Yeah.
No rain, which is great. And I wish you guys were down here doing the show. We could have a few laughs.
Yeah, you missed it. A couple of years ago, Joe and I did the remote twice from down there, and it was quite an ordeal. So I got to see. I don't know. You know, we could do it again, but I don't know if with the remote, with the equipment we have, if we have the ability to zoom in, Chris. That's the one thing I don't know.
Right.
So because you need internet and all, and that's always a problem. So yeah, we'll work on that, Rick. It's always open for the future.
Yeah, sure.
Good. You know, I'm here with somebody, John Romano, who has an original 1969 GTO that he's the original owner. He's about 83 years old. And
oh,
you
wow.
get a kick out of this car here, too, because it's just the original stock, and he's got so many stories to go along with you. I know it. You and him would probably get along real well.
We'll line him up for a lunch date.
That sounds like a great idea.
You got it.
Fellas, thank you so much for having us on the show. We appreciate it.
Always a pleasure, Rick. Thank you.
All right, guys. Take care.
All right. Bye. So long.
Thanks, Rick.
That was field reporter Rick from Lieutenant Rick from Tobe with Stan Rivera from the Corvette Society and Tony Kirk. Tony's a great guy. This 57 is a full-on... I mean, my car's a resto mod, but his car is like the resto mod du jour. I mean, literally, like all the... He's got all the old and the very, very new in a very, very old body. So he really epitomizes the top shelf of resto mod, which is...
I remember the resto, the 57 Corvette resto mod that we had on the show when we did that episode of South Bronx.
Hard Parts South Bronx.
Hard Parts South Bronx.
Oh, that was my friend Tom's car.
That was Tom's.
But that wasn't really a resto mod. That was it had a different V8 in it. It was different. Yeah, it was a different small block Chevy, not a 57.
Yeah,
it was just a little newer.
Totally a resto mod. That was. Yeah. That was a track car.
That car, right. That car had been turned into a track car by the previous owner, and then Tom got it and was kind of streeterizing it again. You know,
that's what he was doing?
Taming it down a little bit.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it took the 513 gears out and put in something in the 3 Series. Yeah, so that car kind of went the other way. That was a race car that got...
you don't want to pull away from a traffic light and doing like 6,000 RPM.
No. So let me tell you this, because the guy, I don't have all the information. I was hoping to have it by today, and I don't. So Joe was telling me a while ago that he was really carping over this new inspection. He says, you know, I went through it all. He said went through the sniffer test, went through the, the rollers. We had the dynamometer. That was crazy. And all the versions, because the version we have now is the best version they've had, and it works. The stickers don't fade. Everything is fine. Why do they got to screw it? He goes, I know, because somebody's son or daughter or daughter-in-law got a job in the with the state, and now they decide they got to change things. So now the idea is, the big thing to me is the sticker itself. Now I don't have one. Kevin does. I didn't get one. You could need a sticker that is an inside adhesive or an outside adhesive, depending what you have inspected. Inside adhesive is anything with a windshield, right?
Right.
Outside adhesive is motorcycle or trailer.
Oh, got it.
Right?
Okay.
Trailer, snowmobile, things like that. Yeah. It's an outside adhesive. So they had separate stickers. So now it's one sticker that apparently can use the adhesive on either side, depending which side you peel or something.
That's odd.
And, ingenious idea, pay somebody to make, somebody's, uncle who's got a printing company now made a fortune off a state contract. So whatever. Right. That, notwithstanding, that could be a great idea. I'm not arguing that. But Joe said now there's a new printer for it. He goes, what's the best color printer for a shop? White, right? Yeah, they give us a white printer. How stupid.
Oh,
Joe was really going. He was off the rails.
So the printer itself is white.
Yeah. Oh, he was off the rails.
Oh, yeah. That's going to last a long time.
But now, I don't have that sticker. Kevin got one on his van. It gets a safety sticker. And he said, he sent me a quick picture a couple months ago. I didn't save it. It doesn't look like a New York State inspection sticker. It looked kind of fakeish. It had some red in it and white. It was a whole different design for the sticker.
Right.
So, of course, why not change everything, right? Might as well. Well, Joe just told me this week, one of his customers came back and got a ticket. And the ticket was for the inspection sticker. And that's what I wanted to find out. I wanted to find out exactly how that ticket was written. Like, what is the infraction? So, it's kind of funny because I have the vehicle traffic code book at home. I have a copy of it. I mean, the book is like 2-3 inches thick, right? It's big. It's like a Bible. It is the Bible for any infraction you can get.
Amazing. So I have never even heard of this.
I had ran up by Cliff and ran up by Rick, and they weren't sure. They thought maybe it could be a traffic enforcement agent who didn't get the memo about the new sticker. And, I don't know what the real where the real downfall was. But I look in the vehicle traffic book, and then I send Billy Velvet an email. I said, hey, Bill, let me include you on this. I got the other guys working on it. What do you think? He says, boy, it's been a long time since I had to deal with stuff like that. He goes, but I think it's section 306. Well, wouldn't you know, you go in that vehicle traffic book.
He remembers, the section?
3 inches thick. You open that book, section 306. And then it's like subsections, A, B, C, D, E. He was right on the money, even not having dealing with it for 20 years.
Oh, my gosh. But, that man is incredible.
But that really didn't help because all the infractions in there were, you know, missing inspection sticker, improperly displayed, torn, defaced, double hit, double clicked, or whatever. So,
or just like Mark from Levittown would put the
defaced
poop,
a defaced sticker, right?
Fake pigeon poop on over the sticker.
But none of it went to like looking like a fake sticker or I don't know. So I wanted to ask Joe again if he could get me some confirmation on that, what the actual ticket was for. So I don't know. So, and I'm curious to see if more people are going to be getting tickets for these stickers if the word didn't get out to the troops. So,
right. Well, that would be kind of odd. Wouldn't you think that the ticket enforcers would be first to know?
You would think.
Of any impending changes to the stickers themselves, I would assume that would be the case.
Now, maybe somebody came back from vacation, didn't read the memo sheet, didn't check the law. Yeah, who knows? It could be anything. It could be one person that just did that. I want to see if that's what I said. I want to see if it's going to continue, and we're going to hear more about it. I don't know. So
interesting.
It's out there. So.
Yeah. See, we don't have to worry about that here in a nutmeg state because we don't have stickers in the window anymore. We lost that privilege years and years ago.
I changed my protocol, too. I now don't have two license plates anymore on my car, right?
Yes.
I was able to put a World's Fair plate on my car.
Which you did.
In certain years, in it was 64 and 65, it was a one-plate deal, and then you put like the World's Fair plate in front. And actually, I have one that my brother had given me from a guy at a swap meet many years ago, and I wanted to use that one because it says Ray 75, and I bought my car in 75, but I couldn't. They said that it may be that number may be out there as a vanity plate somewhere, so they didn't recommend using it. So Cliff took a plate off the wall in his garage and gifted it to me, and this plate has history. It was his wife's grandfather's plate on his 57 Chevy, the first plate. Then his, let's see, I forgot how it went. It was, then the daughter got the car. She drove it with that plate. Then Cliff got the car and kept that plate in the 80s. So he was the third owner of that plate. And then it got put on the wall. And the car got sold and plate got put on the wall. So now I'm the fourth user of that plate that now has a history I could trace back to, 1957 at least.
I'm wondering if that
64. I'm sorry,
because that's what you need. You need, when you look at a plate, when you get an old plate, it still has to be the number sequence, the number letter sequence, still has to be not activated. It can't be used anywhere else.
That's correct.
So that has to be unique to in the state of New York. That has to be the only one. Well, so what did you do? Did you take that plate and like bring it in and go, okay, I have the history.
No. There's a number you call. It's not the regular DMV. It's a special branch of DMV. And these people know their stuff. I spoke a woman, I think Mary Ellen, an older woman, older than me at least, and she knows her classic plates because we were running it down. She knew everything. And I gave her that number, and the number happened to be, she goes, oh yeah, that was just a regular run. It starts with QU. She goes, that was issued in Queens. BK was, I think, was Brooklyn. So she goes, yeah, yours was just a regular run plate. She goes, not a problem. She goes, no one's going to ever have it. Who's going to ask for that, that series of numbers? She goes, so you're good.
So, I'm glad she had the confidence to give you that advice.
She knew her stuff, and I asked her, because now I could, I actually had a conversation with her. We were on the phone for about a half hour, and I said, I know that was a one-year plate. I said, so I'm free to put anything in the front that I want. She goes, yep, whatever you want, you can put in front, as long as it's not another license plate. I said, okay. But so I said to her, was that ever done before? And she gave me a list of years that New York State had a single plate, going back to the 40s. And in the 50s, a couple of them. And then there were years where they kept the same plate, but you had to put a metal tag on it.
Right.
For the next year.
That.
So if you want to register a car with those metal tag plates, you need the plate and you need the metal tag.
Oh, geez.
So that's a little tougher to find. So, yeah, she really knows. She knew her plate history, which phenomenal. But yeah, so it's a black plate. It looks like a California plate that everybody covets so much, you know. Because in California, the plate stays with the car. Many other states do that too.
Yeah, they call them black plates. Yeah, yes.
Right.
It's so a clever name, right?
It kind of goes good with the color of my car. It kind of, you know, kind of corresponds nice. I kind of like the look of it, you know.
And you can see these pictures of the back of Ray's car if you go to Real underscore Motormouth Radio.
That's true on Instagram. But also today I'll post some pictures of things we talked about on this episode of Motormouth Radio, and that'll probably be one of them.
And hopefully you'll get a four-minute vignette of the best of this program on YouTube and Instagram, so those people that don't have enough time to watch the entire show, they get a four-minute treat.
And that seems to be going over well. People like that, by the way. I can see. I'm looking at the numbers, and people watch it, so that means they like it. So I don't know.
They can only tolerate us for about 4 minutes. That's it. It's after a while to get their fill.
Well, there's something else that goes on that I don't know if they like. I don't know how much they like it because they never really say. But it's the honor group of the hour. So do we have one to share today? Because we won it last week, and Brian was actually thinking about it. He came up with a little something for us last week, but.
Right.
Yeah, best we could do.
I got to check out the show just to listen to it. I didn't get that far. I got about 4 minutes in before I got tired of you guys. So, today, because of all the wet weather we had this week, the Motormouth Radio Honor Group of the Hour, if you needed to bail the water out of your car, did you ever open the driver's door just to find more water inside the car than outside the car? Did you instantly notice the little lake directly under the gas pedal? Did the seat make a squish noise when you sat down and your butt instantly got cold and wet? Hey, how about the trunk? Did you find your spare tire floating? Well, if this weekend involved a bucket, a stack of towels, and maybe a few hair dryers all on the driveway, then you are part of the Motormouth Radio Honor Group of the Hour, so stay dry.
I tell you, that's going to be going on now because I saw there's more cars around here that are hydrolocked that was plowed through the water and dead in the water. And I did that once. And I didn't even plow through the water. I went through slow, and I hydrolocked the motor, so it's not hard to do. It is not.
I think I got one sitting in my garage right now, I totally understand.
And like yours, mine ran. You know, I had it sent to a shop, and they actually pulled the plugs, and they said they were shooting water out of the cylinders.
Oh, jeez.
And then the motor ran. I took it back and drove it, and it ran okay. It ran fine. I did notice just the slightest little imperfection that I could pick up on. I forget if it was like when it happened, but I knew it was there. And the guys at the shop were good enough to know, like, they said, listen, most shops would tell you, you're crazy. Drive the car, it'll be fine. So, but we know you know your car, and you know when something's different. And it went back in again for another claim, and it got a new engine. Well, not new, they got an engine from the next newest year put in the car.
Okay. So. Okay. Yeah. Well, it's funny because, I mean, I don't know what to do with this thing. It's one of those, do I pop the piston out and do it, or do I just let it go the way it is and hopefully someone else will.
Yeah. Even a swap of motor, do you want to go through the labor, the cost? For what kind of money are you going to get for it? You know?
The funny thing is, and this is the scary part, everything on this car works.
I know.
Everything on this car is.
But still, what's the street value, though?
Not really. We're not talking about breaking the bank.
Right.
It's a Mitsubishi Galant.
Right.
That's what it is. So it's like, what do you do? I always thought to myself, find someone that has a love for these things.
Yeah, right.
And they're out there.
Yeah.
It's just a matter of doing that.
If you don't break the bank, but you break your back, you can always listen to Your Family's Health on this station, Tuesdays at 3 p.m. Mm. Professor Janine Cook-Garrard from the NCC Nursing Department discusses health issues concerning us all. And like what happens when you pull you back with the motor. And also, I'd be remiss, and I'd be hunted down like a dog and shot probably if I didn't say that. Your WHPC weather forecast, powered by Pentanos, with locations in Hewlett, Uniondale, Garden City Park, Freeport now, and Levittown sponsors this fine station. And our forecast today is beautiful. We're in the 70s. It was sunny when I came in, dry, lots of sun today. Tonight, clear skies, low 61. Tomorrow's going to be in the 60s. We're in for a week of the 70s now, which is cool because I'm going to go to a birthday party for my buddy, Chris, and he's having a 70s-themed birthday party.
Ooh.
Because he was born. See, he was born in the 70s.
Come on.
I lived through the 70s.
Yeah, so you're going to go reach into to your closet and get the Kiana shirt. You got your polyester pants.
The Kiana shirts don't fit, but I don't have them anymore. But I used to have those. Oh, they were so hot, man. They were so hot. Yeah, I
had you have the puka beads?
I do. I still have a string of puka beads. Yes, I do.
I'm sure you do. Yeah.
Yeah.
So you're going to have your orthopedic socks and your high heel sneakers?
I may do the old, oh, crap. What was his name? We had him in here, the bass player for Kiss.
Ace Frehley.
No, Ace Frehley is the guitar player. We had him in the studio many years ago, and remember he had the blackest goatee in the world. It was like so.
Oh yeah. What was the band? I can't
Kiss.
Think of the band's name. Was it Kiss?
He was playing with
what?
Kiss. Yeah. But I was he played with Kiss. But I was oh no, I'm sorry. No. Wait a minute. No, you're right.
No.
He played with Dee Snider. Yeah, played with those guys.
Oh, for God's sake.
So I just told my wife
Twisted
yesterday.
Twisted Sister.
A Twisted Sister, right. I said maybe I should bust out the black hair dye and dye my mustache black, like jet
nice.
Black. Maybe,
yeah.
I don't know. You know, because I got to go back a few years. So, I don't know. But I'll tell you what, we are going to go back a few years because with our music, now you're going to hear more Wes, Bruce, and Lang. And this song I've played before, whenever we do something where somebody was hurt and we're talking about doctors or hospitals, this song is called The Doctor. And this is one of the rockin'est songs. I would play this song and Joe would be bouncing off the... he used to play this one in his band, and it was one of his favorites. So, Joe, if you're out there listening, this one's for you. And then we'll be back with more Motor Mouth Radio with Ray Guarino and Chris Switzer here on WHPC 90.3. Get the nurse.
Back with answers to your car questions. Give us a call at 516-572-7440. Oh, I should have said the Motor Mouth thing.
This show on 90.3 WHPC is brought to you by Car Star Celebrity Chase Collision, with two locations in Limbrook and Oceanside, who remind you that New York State law says you always have the right to choose which shop will fix your car. Car Star Celebrity Chase Collision offers a full range of services, 24-hour towing between Montauk and Manhattan, shuttle service, and they can help you with a rental car arrangement if needed. All repairs include the Car Star Lifetime Nationwide Warranty, ensuring that the experts at Celebrity Chase Collision are always on your side.
Y si hablamos español.
More information is available at 516-593-0920 or online at celebritychasecollision.com.
You're listening to the Motor Mouth.
Hey, Ray and Chris.
Did you guys read my mind?
Okay, I appreciate you having me on.
Wow, you guys finally figured it out.
Motor Mouth.
This is great. No more foolishness.
I miss my puzzles.
You're a funny guy.
I've been waiting for Sunday just to ask you guys this question.
Our trained staff of two will help.
Well, good afternoon, guys. I need a little advice.
All right, so you got me to call it. All right.
I don't know everything. You know, you guys are mechanics.
You guys have a great show. Thank you very much.
I come with a tale of woe and a warning for the younger guys.
Chris is doing jumping jacks. He's getting ready. Ray is right behind me.
Every time I get off the air, I think,
vote him out.
Oh, boy, they're never going to ask me back after that one.
Yeah, this is a collect call. How are you?
Quite frankly, there are better things to do with your time.
Oh, I probably called the wrong number. I was trying to get a hold of Ray. And I wake up screaming.
So I'm very happy to listen to your good advice.
Yeah, I want to know what the is wrong with my car.
You know, break it down for us car guys.
All right, see you next weekend.
Vote him out.
I know you guys usually speak Guido.
Right.
And now you're talking Pintle and Yiddish. And this morning I happened to listen to the rabbi on your station. So it's all, you know, I guess today's Yiddish then.
Right.
There are answers, sometimes correct ones. And we may have them.
Motor Mouth Radio, 90.3 FM, WHPC.
Motor Mouth!
Hey, you, get over here. Every Sunday, 12 to 1, you are going to tune in to hear the Motor Mouths, my friends Ray Guarino and Chris Switzer. 90.3 FM, WHPC. You might learn something.
Okay, I'm going to tell you what you might learn. I cued the wrong song. I did.
Oh.
When I went to the CD player before, I hit the wrong number. So now you're going to hear a couple of seconds of The Doctor because I have to play it. So
listen to The Doctor. Feel like you want to. Go listen to The Doctor. Tell me that you wanna.
It's going to be nothing like that. No, it's going to be nothing like
that.
Not
the Doobie Brothers.
No, you got to like channel your early 70s vibe, and you know, you need a P bass, you need Leslie West on guitar, for cripe's sakes. Come on.
No.
You know what?
That's good.
That's good.
Looking for the FBI.
That's not bad. That's a little better, but let me indulge you. Bass. That's a P bass.
All right.
Don't you send me to doctor, because I'm dying of blues. I got nothing to live for and nothing to lose.
One of those typical angst-ridden songs from the 70s, you know, just talking about the stuff, but...
Yeah.
Yeah, Leslie kicks it up. I mean, he really belts it out on this song. He does a great... The music is phenomenal and, you know... Listen to the bass. And that's where he's got jokes, being a bass
player.
That'll
definitely grow hair on your teeth. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, the doctor. Wes, Bruce, and Lang, great stuff. Go check it out. Go to your local record store and find it, because you know, you should support your local record stores. I do whenever I can, and I find that it's fulfilling to do that. It really is.
So I see you've been busy this week. I've been looking on Real_MotorMouthRadio on Instagram. I see that you got you did some trunking.
You know, yes. Interesting you say that. I had I didn't get to tell you the story. Or did I? At the Malba show, at the end of the day, I had lost my keys. Did I tell you that story?
Oh, you certainly did.
Right. I don't know if I told it to you on air, though. That's the thing.
No, you could... You can tell it again.
I lost my keys, couldn't find them, which was odd. It ends up they were locked in the trunk of my car, which is even odder. So, and to get in the trunk of a car is not that easy without doing damage. So, after I drove home, got my spare keys, came back, got the car, everything was cool. The next day, I go into my Ames catalog, and what do I order but a power trunk release for a 65 GTO. Right. And that was what I posted on how I had to install that. You do have to cut the opening bigger to fit this, because the latch mechanism has now the solenoid as a part of it, so it's bumped. And you can see in the pictures, you know, I had to take maybe 3/16 off, but I was...
I see.
But the deck lid is double wall. It is actually a double wall lid.
Ooh.
So I had to use my die grinder with a, it looked like a milling bit at the end of it, you know, a grinding bit. And then I went to a stone to kind of close in on it and get it, you know, because I didn't want to do any unnecessary damage.
I see. That's what you're using in the picture. It looks like some sort of stone on like a drill almost affair.
That's a die grinder. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's just a die grinder.
Yeah. So how well did the stone... Did you eat through it? I'm sure you did.
You do. The stone definitely gets worn down, so you have to keep moving it to get a different spot. But the stone is good because it works a little slower. Like that mill bit that I was using, the end mill bit, that thing will bite. If you really push into it, it'll bite, and it can go where you don't want it to go. So that thing can get you in trouble very fast. So like I said, I kind of roughed in with that, then went to the stone. I actually did rough in the beginning with a saw. I did a little bit of saw cutting. So and then it's a matter of, you know, just running the wires. You're on a switch. There's a big red button now in the glove box.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, I ran my wires from the fuse. They said find a spade terminal on the fuse box that's battery powered all the time and fused. I'm like, okay, well, I found one that's battery powered, but it doesn't have a fuse attached. It's not on a fuse leg. So I said, okay, I took a inline fuse.
I was going to say just a regular barrel inline fuse, I hope.
Well, I used a blade style, because I had them both. I used a blade style. And I actually wrote on it trunk, because now you got these fuse holders, and what are they for under the dash? You know, you fuse things, and you forget what the fuses are for. So I said, okay, I'm not going to power that up until I get everything done, so I don't have any shorts or anything. And I pre-checked that the trunk release on the bench with a power supply. Click, 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 nice and heavy click. Great.
Good.
Get everything done, wires run, go over, hit the button, and nothing. I'm like, ugh, nothing. Double check the wires there. Just ran the wires. I soldered some wires. Nothing. And of course, you have to hit the button four times to find out it doesn't do anything, right? You can't just do it once.
Right.
And then it hit me. Oh, right. I didn't plug it into the fuse box because I didn't want to have it live while I was playing with the other wires, right, dummy? So go over there, plug it in, hit the button, boom, the trunk. Then I found that I had to do a little trunk adjusting.
Okay.
Because when I first put it in and lowered the trunk, the latch hit the latch in the deck lid hit the latch mechanism on the body and just went and wouldn't close, wouldn't go in. You know, they weren't. So I took the body instead of fooling with the one on the car because I would have had to move more metal. I took the one on the rear panel, and
which is also adjustable.
Those two bolts let it move up and down and right and left a little, and I played with that. I moved it a little to the side, and now it would close. So I closed it.
But now, how are your? You know how I?
Yes.
I go,
oh yeah.
You know where I'm going with this. How does the trunk now sit up against the quarter panels and at the top of the bumper? How does that work? Or the top of the valance, I should say. How does it sit there?
Actually, it sits good now. Well, that's the weird thing with my car. My deck lid was always like a little bit higher in the back toward the quarter panel extensions.
That would make me crazy.
And there is no valance. My deck lid has an overhang. It's like an overbite, so it hangs over, and then I have that filler panel between the taillights, and it doesn't really line up, you know, like square with anything. It doesn't do that. But I had to go through some adjustments on that latch, and I found that if I raised it too high, now I had a big gap on the ends of the. Oh, no good. But I had a nice solid latch of the latch. Said okay. Right. So then I brought it down, and if I went too low, it would drop it down, and it's only going to go so far, and then it would just, it would barely catch the latch. I said, well, that's not too good either. So I had to split the difference in the middle somewhere, and it's about where it was before, which is, it's okay. It's passable, you know, it is. I mean, if I had my choice, I would like to have that gap a little different, but it's just the way that car is with that deck lid, so, and it's painted, so we're not changing that now. It's back to where it was, which was acceptable, I feel. And now I literally can never get locked out of the car because even if the doors are locked and the windows are up and the vent windows are latched, you can get into the front of that car with a coat hanger. Not a problem. It's a hard top, so there's no track on
the
door.
Pull the side window just, you know, from the frame glass and get in there with your hand, I'm sure.
Absolutely. And so the inside of the car there is a piece of cake, and now I have the trunk latch. So as long as the battery has juice, I can, you know, I can.
We got to do something about that Radio Shack red candy-like button you have in the glove compartment, which from the picture looks like the most shallow glove compartment I have ever seen. What can you?
It is.
You could stand up a pack of cigarettes.
That's about it.
Who are you going to kill with that? Why is that like? Is that the way it always has been?
No. The glove box used to be about a foot deep.
What did you do?
I put vintage AC in the car. So now I have the evaporator with the motor and all behind there, which they provided that little half of. I said it's just like a half a glove box. I want to get a little ice cube tray and just stick it in there because it looked like an ice cube tray.
That's not a glove box. That's a suggestion.
Actually, you know what I have in there? What fits perfect? I have the old dome light, which looks like a butter tray. You know, it's rectangular. Right. And in that, I have a couple of small things I don't want to roll around. That fits right in there perfect. And a pair of sunglasses. And that's it.
That is hysterical. Because I'm looking, I'm like, okay, I see the red button. I'm like, all right, Ray's going to have to do something about that. He's got to go back to Radio Shack and get another button. But I'm like, wait a minute. What is with that glove box? It is literally an inch and a half deep.
Right. No, well, that's what they that's what they gave me, and like I said,
stand up a pair of gloves. That's it.
Yeah, I'm fine with that because I really I have the console, which is right now out of the car. I'm restoring my console. I want to change the shift handle, so to do that, I had to take the console out, and now I started refurbing it and painting and doing some stuff. So I'm not done with that yet.
So what shift handle are you going with?
Well, I had,
You're not going with the T-handle, are you?
No, not the handle itself, the actual stick.
I'm
going to keep the ball.
Come.
We already determined that with the TKO transmission, I did originally put my T-handle shifter on it because that's what I always liked to drive. But it didn't feel right.
Because you haven't grown up, I know.
But it didn't feel right on that transmission. And years ago, we had a guy in the show from Keesler. That's the company I got the transmission from. They sold out to Silver Sport Transmissions. And he asked me, what did I have on top? And I said, well, I had a T-handle, but I switched to a ball. And he says, aha, so you figured it out. They're made to be used with a ball. Aha. It's an internal rail shifter. And
I agree. I like the ball.
Yes, I'm glad you do. It does just feels right. So I'll keep the Hurst ball, but the stick itself. The stick that they gave me, I wanted a stick that said Hurst. I like having a Hurst shifter in the car.
Okay,
and
that's cool.
So I had two sticks. I have another one, but it's part of the shifter. You can't take it out. And it ends up the one I had in the car was out of a second gen Camaro, which was kind of cool. Because it let me have part of my old Camaro back. But
that was part of the old Camaro?
Yeah. But now I went back to the other stick that I had in the garage, which is like a 65 to 67, 65-72 Chevelle GTO style stick. I took pictures of them, and really what they have the same height and same curve, except the Camaro had like a little offset in it that actually brought the stick a little further to the left, to the driver, which I thought was going to be a better position.
So would I.
The Chevelle and GTO shifter is more straight in the center. So I drove the car a couple times with this other one, and I kind of like it. I thought I was going to hate it, and I don't hate it. I think I kind of like it. And I think what it'll do is, I have a cup in my console that the stick comes through. And I noticed that I had repainted that a while ago, and it had gotten scratched up from the bottom of the shifter hitting it because I think with the Camaro shifter, it was going over a little too far. Now I think if I go with this one more centered, I think I'll alleviate that problem. So
you'll avoid smacking it up against the side of the console. Get it? Okay,
right.
I get it.
Right.
Very cool. Wow. So that's what you're up and doing now, since you got the console in pieces.
I have part of it restored. I have to do the rest. We'll go from there. The other thing that happened during the week was Kenny Wessel from Convention with Kenny. Check him out on YouTube. He set me up with a company called Kingbolen. Kingbolen makes scanners.
Ooh, nice.
So this is a tablet-style scanner. And I don't know if you can see the readout. It looks kind of washed out.
Yes, it does look washed. I can barely make it out from where I'm looking here. If you're looking at YouTube, maybe you can be able to make it out, but no, I can see it.
It's a tablet-style scanner that's kind of like it mirrors the launch scanners, which are kind of easy to use. So I played with it with the Toyota. I want to use it on another couple cars. It's been so rainy, I haven't had a chance to do anything with it. So they sent that to be,
reviewed?
Reviewed, checked out, yeah. See, so
very cool. So you've got a scanner to review?
Yeah, I want to go through a couple more cars and see what I can see. It's, playing. I don't, right now, of course, now I don't have any cars with a check engine light on.
I'll give you the Mitsu if you want.
I might actually force a code. I might actually, disconnect something, force a code.
Got it.
But I know how they are pretty easy to use, the tablet-based ones. They're pretty nice. So
what do they go for? Because I'm actually looking for a better scanner than I have. What does something like that go for?
They sell these through Amazon, and they are very reasonable. This one is kind of the middle of the line. This is the S600. And if you look this one up, it's about $400.
Okay.
But for the power of a tablet, the launches is about $2,500. And if you were to buy it from, say, Snap-on, it'd be like $5,000. So it offers a good... I kind of like the one that's above this because that lets you do bidirectional control where you can turn things on and off.
That
was the next step up. That's the one that I think I would be interested in if I was to, purchase one, get my hands on one. But the interface is good. They're a little slower than like the Snap-on or the Macro scanners. They seem to be a little quicker. This thing is Kenny complained about that in one of his videos. And then when I was using it in my car, I said, I can see. I want this thing to be a little snappier if I was actually doing you know, real diagnostic. You know, you don't want to wait. You don't want to wait.
Oh, what's the lag time?
Yeah, I don't know. You know, a couple milliseconds. You know, when you push a button, you want something to happen, and sometimes now with this, you push it and you have to wait a second or two. So, you know, you don't want that. That's not preferred.
God, he's got to wait a second or
two. I know.
Time is valuable.
Well,
gotta wait a second.
That's
God.
I said, when you're doing diagnostics, you know, you want to blast through. You want to get an answer. You don't want to pussyfoot around. You want to get the heck out of there. So I got to tell you something else. We may have. Let me find it. Hold on. I'll get it in Kim's way. No.
Oh, okay. Good. Why are you doing that, Ray? Just wanted to let you know.
Yep. Let me know.
This morning, I had a mushy, overripe banana.
Oh, good. That's how I like
it. Just to let you know that every time I have a mushy, overripe banana, I think of you.
That's how I like them. I like them like that. We're going to have a guy on. I thought it was going to be today, but it didn't happen. He wrote this book, OBD1 and OBD2.
Obla di, obla da. Nice.
And that's this is like an ANOVA scanner. I have one of those, too.
Yes, I have one similar to that as well.
Not a tablet based. That is an ANOVA, in fact.
Right, that's a handheld. OBD1, OBD2. Yeah, that looks like a book I'd like to dig into as well.
Greg Banish wrote this book, and I tell you, Joe is the guy that should interview him, because he gets into the stuff with the scanners the way Joe did. The stuff behind the stuff. You know?
I know. So just to keep everybody from not putting their head up against the counter going.
So we'll see. It didn't work out for today. We may have Greg as next week's guest. And also, I'll be talking about, I'm going to be at the Olds meeting on Wednesday. Kilowatt Kevin's come with me.
Body parts and autographing and car parts, I'm sure.
Yeah,
right?
Kilowatt Kevin's coming. Rick may be coming with me too. And we're going to see the people from Nassau Chrome. So I'm going to see if I can line them up for a guest spot on the show.
Yeah, now we're talking.
Because I did go see them with Mike when I was doing my car, and I wanted to get my bumpers done. They don't do them in-house, but they can officiate the job, and it was going to cost like thousands of dollars for my bumpers. And I was like, forget it. I went with AMD, and I spent like $600.
Right, and you got the aftermarket.
And they look fine.
How do you like them? You like they're okay?
The one difference I noticed is as soon as I took it out of the box, it was lighter. The bumper feels lighter. So,
but I guess they don't expect you to use them as bumpers.
But they look phenomenal. The chrome is beautiful. The plating is top shelf. You know, AMD makes some real nice stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Very cool. I like it. I like that. That's so good.
We'll be doing that.
I know I probably would have to do the same thing for the Chrysler, but
yeah.
I don't think they make boxes big enough for those bumpers, though.
Oh, they would, because we were looking at having the 56 Imperial done at the time, which had, and they wouldn't do it. He says, no, it's too big. He goes, we can't do that. It's way too big. So
yeah,
I don't know what the fellow did about that, but yeah.
Very true. I believe it. Well, it sounds like we got a full card coming up on this fine, upstanding program.
Yep.
So they're not going to throw us off for some obscure gardening show. So I'm very pleased about that.
We'll be talking with Nassau Chrome, and we'll hopefully line them up between them and Greg. One of them should be in next week. And we want to get Carl Anthony back in again. Of course, we want to keep him in rotation.
Yes. And, you know, you do have to call him, because he'll think that he made some faux pas or something like that, and that you stopped calling him.
I know.
You don't want him to think that way.
So Kim is ready with Thunder Road. Best of Springsteen and the band. And what do we say to the people who are waiting for me out in the parking lot?
Don't follow us home unless you have another red candy-like button you can give to Ray.
You got it. The one I had through Riviera was yellow.
Oh, okay.
You know what? The glove box closed. You don't see it, so whatever. All right. For Chris Switzer, Ray Guarino, Motor Mouth Radio out. We'll be back next week. WHPC 90.3. See ya.
See ya, bye.